Pamela Aaralyn here.
I will tell you there is one specific question that he does not seem to be answering, and that is the what is my personal connection to you question. Right straight from the gate, he told me that he's not fond of that question. He's pretty saucy and pretty passionate, a very divine masculine being, a little fiery. What I've noticed about my last few days of pulling him in around me is that he has a particular way of operating where he likes to burn out the ego. And that holds no coincidence to my most recent spiritual transition of burning out the ego. So that's been fun, considering everything that I have very publicly and personally been going through. So that's been fun. He works towards the weakest chakra system that you have, and he will burn it out to the extent that I personally woke up with a massive throat chakra virus, and I actually bit my tongue during dinner last night, and it is bruised. So if you notice a lisp, that is where that is coming from. If you hear any echo, I'm noticing someone in chat stating that they're hearing an echo. If that's the case, I would put on your headphones, because it is the reverberation of your microphone. So the echo is something that you can get rid of by putting on your headset or your earbuds or anything like that, any microphone that you can attach that might be external, as opposed to utilizing the the internal speakers. So that will get rid of that. He is a strong, strong, strong being. And I personally have to admit to you that I have not done a lot of channeling of this being. So I was really surprised. And when you guys voted from my Facebook page, which, by the way, you can find at facebook.com/groups/4reader. When I brought him in, I did not expect you guys to vote for him. I'll tell you that right away. I thought it was going to be Metatron today. Because he's my favorite, and I thought automatically, yes, of course, they're going to choose my favorite, you know, ego, right? And it didn't happen, and that's awesome, because I needed this experience, and apparently the universe chose exactly what we needed to go through. But I will tell you that over the course of the past 3 days, as I've been bringing in his energy, that it has been remarkably strong. Lights have been flashing, technology has been crashing, things have been occurring in my life that's been amazing since I've been working with him. So, but in terms of your echo, if you're having an echo problem, a technology problem, I would suggest refreshing your screen, because it's very, very interesting how his particular energy field and the strength of it seems to mess with technology just a little bit more than most of the angels that I regularly channel. I have not publicly channeled him before. I have privately channeled him for one-on-one type of, you know, client, you know, teacher-student interaction, and for friends and family here and there, about, I want to say, 4 times in my life. And I have channeled him personally for me twice, when I was very ill, for me to gather up my strength. And he healed in a way that empowered me. There was an illumination from within that caused that external force of enlightenment to come thereafter. And then it pushed out all of the things that needed to go out. It was like a toxic release. He released everything that was toxic. And that is what he's been doing since yesterday. For me. So if someone is asking, did my face feel burning and go numb? Yes, it does. And for those of you who are strong into your empathy and your clairsentient gifts, it will definitely do that. So he is a very dominant, strong, burning, passionate, release of the ego type of being. And I don't mean release, like get rid of it. I mean cleanse it of everything that's toxic to you. So yeah, it's been interesting. But yeah, someone's asking in the chat, you know, about the face burning and all that kind of stuff, and how it went all the way up through his nose and eyes and everything. And that is exactly what I've been experiencing as well. And my entire throat chakra is on fire, because that was the weakest chakra that I had. And he has just been burning through that and burning through that and calming down all of the toxicity that was there and releasing it. So if my throat sounds a little unusual, that's what's going on with me. That's how this channeling is personally affecting me. And I'm happy about it. I'm happy about the nature of how he's healing, even if it is unusual to me. So, I'm going to tell you some of the things that he's been telling me. And at first, I'm going to go ahead and tell you how he appears, because a lot of people have been asking how he clairvoyantly appears to me when he is here now, and the many times when he has been coming to me. It's not been a specific appearance that looks very human. This is going to be hard to explain. he's very full of illumination. It's a tall being, but it is an androgynous looking being. I don't notice specific levels of feeling, looking at him now, to like male or female or anything like that. There are no wings. There are none of those things that people think. What I notice is a big blue and white sword. I noticed the sword right away. He has that with him at all times, and it's massive. Like, it's probably too big to feel, too big for me to even describe. It's bigger than me, and bigger than you, and bigger than many of us standing on top of each other. So that sword just feels like it's going to come out the ceiling when he's around. And so far as, the energy, like I said, it's white and it's blue, and it's a royal blue. And there's a little bit of red at the bottom of its energy field, like at the very bottom, as if it's a wellspring of something that's kundalini based. He enjoys the root chakra energy in humans very much, and he strengthens it. He also strengthens the point of the Merkaba, which is your source of power. Okay, so that is something that I've noticed, that he operates very strongly from the root chakra and the Merkaba center, which is right there underneath your solar plexus and your chakra system. The Merkaba is your source energy, is basically what that is. That is your empowerment. So I'm going to tell you some of the things that he's been saying to me this morning when I'm in meditation. I wrote them down. I'm not going to be trance channeling him today. I've been doing that for other beings, but he is such a strong being that, being that I have never trance channeled him before, I'm going to use direct mediumship abilities that I have just to be able to see and hear him and return to you what he's been saying to me. So I'm going to tell you what he said to me a few minutes before this channel session this morning when I awakened, and then I will let him come through as he will with saying whatever else he wants to say, and then we will proceed to answer your questions. Okay. So what he was explaining to me this morning, that he's reiterating now as he stands before me, is he's talking about illumination and enlightenment. So he explained to me this morning that illumination of your physical being from your heart center helps you to form an outward external enlightenment, but it starts here. The way he explained to me is that it started, in the heart center, that is your source, like God source is what he was calling it this morning. Okay. So when you go within and you empower the heart center and completely start within to love yourself, only then can you love out others. So he explained that to me right away, and that causes the enlightenment that becomes external towards the world. So he was discussing this morning at about 3:30 a.m., 3:33 actually, is when I remembered that I had to awaken with this message as well, about the wounded healer, that it was concerning him with the nature of the wounded healer. And he pointed that directly at me. He was like, "You were the wounded healer. And when you call upon me, I strengthen those wounds in you to the extent that they are burned away. You burn away your ego, and that is why you had your most recent transition." So he explained to me about, my particular fifth dimensional perception at this point in time, very recent fifth dimensional, like as of 2 days ago. So he explained that to me personally, and then he explained that the center of power from unconditional love towards self has to start at self, because of the level of interdependence that we have, that it isn't independence or codependence that causes that. It's interdependence that he would like for humans to go towards. And that is, what he's causing humans to want to consider. So he explained the elimination of the physical body as well, as it is affected by the heart center and the Merkaba. And that when you open your heart center, that basically your Merkaba strengthens and burns away your ego, not to get rid of it, but to cause it to work within you fully, to activate. He explains himself as an activator. That is the main thing that he's been sharing with me today, is that he's an activator. So, what else does he want to say? He said that the way, this is what he's saying now, and I'm just repeating to you exactly what he's saying. He says the way that humans are incarnating into physical bodies, that needs to be reconsidered. Okay. Very succinct in his way of being. So he's just telling you exactly how he speaks is not very emotional. It's very dot, 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 just like that, a little scientific. So he's saying, it is your personality that automatically helps you develop a desire to share your illumination from within, to share your higher truths that I give to you and that you receive from source with others. This is the enlightened and illuminated path that begins within and externally charges and burns off ego from humanity so that the cycle and patterns of Earth can continue. There will be a cycle. Ascension is occurring in a way that is different from all other levels of ascension that you have presently experienced. You are ascending individually at an individual pace, no longer as a collective. This lighted path is my bridge that I am helping you to form between your third dimensional material world and the realms of spirit. This requires your utmost discipline. I am here to teach you willpower and discipline and knowledge. Those of you who seek wisdom, I am offering discernment to help you clearly decipher your path and to relay this wisdom, to relay my teachings, and to proficiently transmit these higher concepts. I'm still listening, hang on. If you operate from within, this flow must be developed to develop an intense mental clarity, along with an integrated ethical human personality and human will that is dedicated and directed by your oversoul, which is what you know of as your higher self. Your soul is not spirit. Your soul is not matter. It consists of atoms, atom seeds sent forth from the divine mind of your Father God and the spirit womb of our beloved Mother God. These beings sent forth via life breath, breath of the divine Mother God's Holy Spirit, which is all cosmic forms of matter. And this is how you are born. Still listening, hang on. The awakening of your higher self comes from this state of being. It is one of the strongest steps in the evolutionary process of man. In order to become your higher full self, and in order to become aware, you must become aware of what is happening in your world around you and in your emotions and in your mind. You must strengthen and zone in, sharpen your thinking process, live in the power of each moment as it is presented of you. This is the still point of the present. It is often called by humans your power of now. In order to gain this experience and this inner knowledge of which I share, you must consider what you wish to remember and what you wish to retain in your memory. Each of you are a spark of life, a spark of source, a spark of divine mother and divine father God, and of your supreme creator. Each of you has a personal wheel of your own creation, your own flower of life. You must learn to recognize and to use this again, this individual spark within you, in order to become a true co-creator on your earthly plane. The breath is the light. This is why I say to you today that as you breathe in light, breathe out love. When you breathe in light, you're breathing in God particles through your sacred heart center. When you breathe out love, these particles of pure God source essence are empowered and ignited and set aflame by your loving intention, so that they may be blessed and used for the greatest good of humanity. You are the receptacle for these God particles and this essence, and your love is the activator. Thank you. Okay, that was that. I hope that you enjoyed that message. I'm going to turn off all incoming messages to me personally so that I can proceed to answer your questions. I'm going to take a small break because that was really, really strong. And I do have this throat chakra thing coming up as we speak. You're seeing my healing. As we speak, my voice is getting stronger. Can you hear it? It's actually amazing. So I'm going to do that, drink some water, take a 2-minute break, and come right back. Okay. I suggest that you do the same. This is going to be pretty intense. I love you. I'll be back in 2 minutes. I'm just taking them immediately as I see them, and he says yes. Okay, so this is from Jackie. Can I ask Archangel Michael to be near me? He's over there. That's why my face keeps looking off to the side. I'm asking him to stand maybe behind the screen so that I don't have to keep looking over there. But, you know, you don't ask Michael anything. You just kind of follow along because he's really, really strong and ever-present. He's saying anyone can ask. I am everyone's being. I have charge divinely over everyone, and you are my children, but you are also source. You also are to connect and remember God within you and source within you. But yes, of course, you can ask. And I'm there for whoever asks. I hold no particular discernment over who is chosen. You all are chosen. And of course, you can ask and I will answer every time. So, yeah. He's very much like that. He's like, yes, anyone can ask. Let's see. What else we have here that I can put on screen for you? All right. This is from Pupender. Hi, Michael. Thanks for your guidance and protection. I want to know, how do we get you as our subdominant guide? Is it pre-birth agreement? This is a good question. Is it a pre-birth agreement, or is it that you chose the individual you want to help? He says both. I call in anyone who calls upon my presence will be enlightened with my presence and my strength. I only represent the strength within you. It is both. I operate within your soul stream, and you choose your soul stream prior to incarnating as a human. So it's both, he says. Let's see what else we have here. My whole crown chakra feels like it's on fire. Someone just messaged me and asked, how do you feel right now? I'm like, okay, so every organ in my body is activated fully, and everything feels like it's on fire. And it's not necessarily a painful fire, but I feel really, really strong. I'm so surprised my face isn't burning up in red and breaking out. Right. Okay. Yeah, someone said, I told you it's intense. I'm like, you believe me, I know. I don't do this with him very often, so this has been a learning experience that I'm sharing with you. Okay, this is from Harpal, and she is asking, and stating rather, We have negative people really making life difficult. Because of these situations, our life energy is at its lowest point. He nodded when you said that. He's saying, he's interjecting a bit, and he's saying it is a cycle. It is coming to the full point of your cycle. As you have done many times, many, many times, you are at a present point at the end cycle again. Let's see, okay. How can we sever the links with these type of people via Michael, and how do we validate that Michael has helped to cut the links? That's a good question. Let me ask him. Your point of evolution is expansion via contrast, via your duality. Please understand that time is not of a linear degree. Time operates within the spiral of life. Please understand that contrast, as long as you fear it, is going to still exist. Please understand that when you reach a point, he's doing like this, he has his finger here, and now he's actually pointing with the sword. Move the finger, and now it's the sword right there in the center, and then he's moving the sword in a spiral that goes like this, and he said, this is your point of contrast, and when you reach this, you assume that you will have it no more. As long as you assume that you will have contrast no more, you will expand from that point. So like this, you expand and reach a higher point of contrast. You will expand from that point and reach an even higher point of contrast. You are still learning. You are not going backwards. You are not backing up. You are expanding. As long as you should choose to wish for this contrast to be eliminated, whether it is via the reflection of people, it is still you. They are God's source reflecting back to you. If you love them through this contrast and through what you perceive as negativity, then you shall reach a higher point of contrast, and then a higher point of contrast. And he's doing like this around the spiral and goes back to a higher point. So it looks like this point of contrast, spiral around this point, spiral around higher point, spiral around higher point. So this, he's explaining basically how humans evolve. He said, you are not stagnating. This is your perception. This is your perception. You don't need to cut any links. You don't need to cut any cords. If you do that, is that then a perception that you're cutting off yourself? Please stop resisting negativity. What you resist will continue again and further. When you reach the point of contrast wherein you have truly learned, you will welcome the lack of peace. You will welcome what you perceive as negativity, because you will embody the strength and the love to no longer have this negative perception of energy within humans that merely reflect your own higher self. So, I gotta breathe for a second. Hang on. Sometimes he's just jumping in and talking through, and I didn't expect that. I expected to just be able to repeat back to you what I normally do. Like when Yeshua was here, he said something and I repeated it. When Michael's here, sometimes he just jumps in and I'm like, oh, back up a minute. You're awesome, but can you please not do that? But I'm not going to tell him that, because I'm just going to do what he says. Let's take another question. All right. This is from Cody. I know it says it's shown by Jim Management, but he's just posting it for Cody. Archangel Michael, can you tell us more about the UFO sighting over Los Angeles recently? There was a blue light that expanded throughout the sky. What really was that? And what was the purpose of that display? Thank you. The dimensional energy shields and fields between your dimension and others are lifting. You will see and experience more in your material reality within your dimensions than you ever have before. You are seeing what has always been there. You were unaware. Now you can become aware through the adjustments of the cones in your human eyes. You can become aware. You are awakening. Otherwise, you would not have seen it. This indeed was another extraterrestrial force. Extraterrestrial is a definitive term that you use. However, nothing is extra. Everything is and always has been. This was what you know as an extraterrestrial group of beings. This was a collective group of beings from what you know as Sirius. This is the star system that you would identify these beings as. Some of you are saying in chat that you see a blue light crossing your field. Yeah, who does that? I'm seeing it too. It normally looks horizontal, but sometimes it can look vertical, but it just crosses like that or like this, but it is coming from your field connecting to his. That's what that is. I have it right now too. It's above my head. That's how I see it anyway. Let's see. Someone is saying, was it determined that that particular UFO was a missile? He said that is a human misconception and something that was hidden from your knowledge. That is not true. That is not true. That is something that was hidden from your knowledge and created to cause a bit of a diversion in your truth. This is something that your governments do and that your humans do quite often. Okay, he tells it like it is. Okay, let's ask again something further. I like this question, and he does too. This is from Adam. I got this question in yesterday and I couldn't wait to answer it, and I was so hoping that he would, and he had. He answered it yesterday and he's going to answer it again today. He's shaking, he's nodding the head. This is from Adam. I gotta breathe for a moment. Hang on. How do you channel seraphim energy without being overwhelmed with an extreme deep love of wanting to help everyone and everything? It can be overbearing at times. I guess, how could you turn that into a sustainable, positive, driving force used to energize yourself? He says, I would prefer to express to you to change your perception that it is draining or negative. Understand that it is burning and releasing of all toxins when you understand the nature of what is happening to you. When you understand the nature of what will happen first and foremost, all toxicity will be released. And what you perceive as potentially draining and overwhelming and toxic, once that toxicity is released, it will naturally turn into your burning desire, into what you want. It will naturally turn into the extreme love that you wish, and that it will feel as passion. It will feel as drive. It will feel as a motivating desire for truth. It will feel as if you wish to purify the world. I like that he said that, and that's, this is me speaking at this point in time. He's done with his message to you. However, what I like about that is what I've noticed, that he has this passionate, motivating, strength type of energy that causes people to want to step into an ethical degree of higher truth. I like the ethics of this particular archangel. I like that he discusses cleansing and removing of toxicity, strengthening, purifying, things of that nature, that his burning red and blue. I've seen a lot of reds and blues come into that, and it seems like it's going from red when he does the burning away of things within people, that it's red, and then it goes to blue, which causes a release and a peace and a flow, and then it turns into white, which is the divine, the connection of the God particle and the atoms that he was speaking about in his channel message to you earlier. So I like that that's how he operates. Let's see. I loved this question too, although it made me a little sad. And it made my, I'm a heart-centered being. So when I read this question, I went, oh, right? This question is from Suzanne, and it is listed above my head here in the viewer questions and suggestions. I think I'm too low and insignificant to get your help. Is it possible for someone like me to get your advice and guidance, especially with my time now at work with so many egos? I am tired and weary of dealing with this stress. I need your specific advice. Is it possible you can or would communicate with me, and how can I hear you? Thank you with my whole heart. He said there is no truth in the definition of your insignificance. You are not low. You are not lower than. You are not lesser than. Splashing my energy. You are not lesser than. You are not lower than. You are not insignificant. The significance of the God within you is the strongest amount of humility within your core. And for that reason, in your humility, you will be helped and you are being helped. It is up to you to formulate a personal belief system that you can and will be helped. Because the moment you ask, in combination with your belief that you can and you are being helped, start there. The moment that you ask, it is immediately there. Should you receive this help, it is up to you. There are and will and shall continue to be egos amongst humans. There has been since the beginning of what you call time. Should you understand that this is not negative and that this is not set forth with intent to hurt you or harm you? Should you understand that this ego is God staring back in your face? Should you please understand this? And you shall be set free. You shall be liberated. You were not trapped. If you understand that you were not separated, that you are not punished, that this is not a punishment, that you are not low, you are not insignificant, then you shall understand that it is possible to hear and see all that you wish, because this begins from the knowingness in you and it expands outward into your vision and into your hearing. But it must begin with trust of source within you. When you believe that everything is external, how can you believe that anything is internal? Start internally. I am there. I am not out here. The external reflection has to be created from the internal knowing. I can tell that I'm going to be taking a lot of breaks during this channeling. My body is fully on fire. So that being said, I need more water and to use the restroom and to wash my hands again. And I may do this a lot, so your patience is definitely going to be needed. There's a lot of energy going on here. I'm going to take another 1 to 2 minute break. Okay, this question is from Johnny. What have you done for mankind? Physical and non-physical incarnations. He says, I am Elohim being. I do not incarnate. I have not incarnated. I choose to continue not to incarnate. I do channel through your humankind. I typically show myself as an external reflection of something that you need to see within. I have shown myself to a fisherman over the course of your last 100 years on a place that you call Mount Michael. Okay, I don't know of that place, so you guys can go Google that. Okay, fisherman at Mount Michael. Apparently he showed up for that person. He says, I have shown up in orphanages. I love children. I protect children. I've shown my being and my reflection of what you know is Michael in many places. I can tell you where I do not tend to show, and that is in your churches. Surprise, surprise. I can't say I'm shocked, but that's fascinating, Michael. Thank you. I have been an intercessor of your prayers for over 4,000 years. Your prayers are your energy from source, and I have helped you to understand, and I will continue to help you to conceive that your prayers are you talking to you. Is you reaching out to source within you? When you step out of your victim mentality, you should understand that there is nothing to be worshipped. You are the gods. Oh, I'm so glad someone's listing in Mount Michael about the fisherman. Thank you for that link, because I had no idea what he was talking about. He was showing it to me and it looked beautiful. But yeah, fisherman's mind blown, right? Thank you for that link. It's there in your chat. So I guess it's on Wikipedia. Someone just said Mount Michael and it's on Wikipedia. Okay. Let's see, further questions. Okay, this is from Petra. If one is in danger with help needed and calls your name, do you automatically show up for that call? He's nodding. Yes, okay, that's a yes. And how do you decide who to help? He states, I do not decide, I show for all. There is no discretion or discernment. I show for all. I am here to understand and balance out the scales of injustice in humanity. Therefore, I will continue to show for all. Second part of your question, what is the best way to battle what we define as evil? With love, gratitude, and respect, from Petra. Mm-hmm. He says your perception of evil is based upon your view of duality and contrast. It is not that it is bad. This is your perception. Please understand that God is within all, even the things that you would deem harmful. They are all reflections of God playing a role to help you connect and realign to source within based upon your pre-birth contracts and your pre-birth agreements. All is God. When something or someone within their reflections and roles in your life hurts you, it is hard for you in your human conception to understand that this was your choice. This is the hardest portion and lack of understanding of human ego. I understand that you cannot conceive of this at this time in this cycle of earth in which you are presently operating. But please understand that all is a reflection of God, even what you deem as evil. Please allow your definitions of war, murder, rape, pillage. Please step out of victim mentality and step into your strength. You cannot and should not be aligned to any of these perceived evil forces if you are standing with empowerment from source within you. You shall not call this or align this into your life. I'm still letting that flow into my logical awareness and trying to understand what he means. But there's someone in chat that just said energy cannot be created or destroyed. And I want to say that he nodded to that in agreement with you. But insofar as perceptions of evil, it is really hard for me because I have a divine mother present. So when people say evil, I think of war and rape and those things. I understand what he's saying from. I understand that within the wisdom that he's sharing. But for me, the Divine Mother comes out and I'm like, no, that's not okay. So it's hard for me to grasp that humans can be in a role of victimhood, especially when it appears that they are weaker. It appears to us in our consciousness that children are, of course, weaker. and that war victims are just that. So it's hard in my humanness to understand, but at the same time, I feel that if we understand our pre-birth intentions, it helps us understand that a little bit more. And if we understand how to step out of victim mentality, that helps us a little more. Okay. So just opposing vibrations. Someone said that in chat, that how love and hate are the same frequency. They're just opposing vibrations. They are the same frequency in their strength. They're just so different. He's nodding to you with that. And this is just short source finding another way to show it for you. This is how I'm perceiving his comment, and he is nodding. Okay. Yes, like yin and yang. Someone said that in chat just now. Is it like yin and yang? Yes, absolutely. Okay. Here is a really good question from Mariana. Michael, what should we do in times of war? How can we help humanity and be a channel of peace and love during those times? He said you simply answered your question, be a channel of peace and love during those times. Can I just, I love you, but I just have to roll my eyes right now a little bit. Can you elaborate? Yeah. Yeah, I'm looking a little bit above and to the right because that's where he's standing. Someone asked me where was he standing. He's a little bit to the right and behind the computer. See what else he wants to say. Feeling peace within, feeling love within, feeling the presence of peace and love amongst times that are challenging within what you perceive as evil, such as war, is the most difficult concepts for humans to comprehend. What you should do during times of war is to go within for your own peace. When you find peace amidst all conflict, when you find an opposing vibration to war, watch my screen again, repeat. When you find an opposing vibration to what you perceive as evil, then you are shining the light of divinity from within. Then that comes within you, but it starts within you. You cannot shine a light of something of which you truly do not feel or believe. You must feel and believe in order to enlighten. Illumination happens from within, and then you enlighten and shine externally so that your reflection then changes. And then it is no longer war. Then it is contrast that begins to resolve into inevitable peace. It becomes the reflection of what is in you. If war is within you, if victimhood is within you, if you feel disempowered, then the war continues externally. Thank you. Okay. Yeah, there's a lot going on. Someone said, did you see a figure pass in front of her camera? Yes. He's in and around and everywhere and keeps moving. So I keep moving as well in my eyes. Let's see what other questions we have. I'm just scrolling down here for a moment. Okay, this is from Deborah. If you've already asked one question, what I'm trying to do is save your question number 2, 3, and 4 to make sure that I answer everyone's question and everyone gets a chance to answer. Just letting you know. This is from Deborah. What top 2 gifts should I be focusing on? He said, which top 2 gifts do you desire? Your desire is the burning passion for your free will choice, which is God-given. The question should perhaps be, what do you desire? And then it should be given to you based upon that desire. Please understand the power of knowing this, that you have free will to choose your passions. Your passions will fuel your desires. Your desires will fuel your gifts. They are already there for the taking. You already know what top 2 gifts you would like to focus on. You already know that you heal. You already know that you know. Heal and know. Whatever definitions you desire shall come thereby. How much of the U.S. coastlines will be destroyed in the next 2 years? He says, your alignment is ever present and ever shifting. If I should have answered that question yesterday, just yesterday alone, an entire coastline would have been wiped out today. That alignment shifted immensely, immensely in such a short amount of time, to the point that there will be no coastlines that are aligned towards being destroyed over the course of the next 2 years, at least on your West Coast. In other countries, that is a concern. Thailand is aligned towards a shift that should destroy a partial component of its coastline in its current state of awareness. Should they shift that alignment at any present point in time, they will be safe. I cannot answer that question. This question changes constantly based upon your alignment. Okay, Tyler, you need to change that alignment. He's serious. I too have sensed that personally many times. I too have sensed a little bit of changing in the shifts of California, Southern California. So, California should watch it as well, but they're safe for now. I agree with him. He's nodding again. Let's see. What other questions do we have? Okay, this is from Rebecca. Let's put this on the screen here. As soon as it gets on the screen, I will answer it. What's the relationship with angelic beings and the Pleiadians? Are they the same thing or different or both? He says, angelic beings, as you know, within your definition, are not one specific race. They come from a time that is before the creation of your universe, even. Before is a relative term. There is no before, there is no after. However, this is from the levels of understanding in which you currently operate. Elohim beings are not from your universe. They come to your universe via the choice of their will and within their contracts. When they arrive in your universe, they then have the free will, if they choose to incarnate as Pleiadian, as you call it, which is an extension of your Lyran race. And they do. And yes, there have been connections with their particular alignment with the Pleiadian race, but there are many, many connections. And this could be a giant surprise to your knowledge and your awareness. They are not strictly of the Lyran race and of the Lyran descent. They are prime in nature. They come in a way that is of a completely different dimension, even than Lyran. Prior to the Lyran race was in existence in your universe, they were there in another universe that is parallel to your own. Okay, thank you. Let's go to another question. This question is from Layla. Could I ask if there could be something about sex and its importance in my life and ours in general at this time? He says, sex is a sacred creative force that comes from the passion and desire within your light body, stemming from your root and sacral chakras, of which you call them. Sex is a co-creation and a reflection that is divine between divine feminine and divine masculine within you. Yes, there are many human definitions of sex. It is a creative force. The importance of this creative force is vast. There is much wisdom to be gained from understanding this creative force, but it is sacred And when you take this force outside of that sacred creation, and it is no longer sacred, this is a concern, because then your co-creation shifts into something that is not beneficial or conducive to your true divinity. If you should choose to keep the nature of sex sacred and honored and in purity, then your co-creation will reflect to purity and love, abiding agape love. If that is your choice, then the co-creation involved in the act of sex is very, very beneficial for mankind as a whole. If not, then you proceed with the cycles of burning of your earth. This is the importance of the nature of sex in humanity. It can be beautiful, life-forming. It can be burning and life-taking. This is your choice. That was really interesting.
I have a question from Mikhail.
Please speak to the overwhelming migration of Syrians and others. Please speak to the overwhelming migration of Syrians and others in surrounding countries, and the very frightening differences from their point of view, and the West's point of view too. Also Russia and other nations, British nations and friends. The purpose of this understanding is the nature of contrast between peace and war, and your definitions of peace and war, your definitions of giving and taking, of power and victimhood. There are so many representations within this contrast and within these cycles. It is there to instate that there will be no boundaries, no further borders, no further boundaries. Please understand that you are all human and beyond. Why should your nations and your governments inflict borders and boundaries to keep others out? This is occurring so that we as a human conscious collective can transcend these borders and boundaries, these cores of limitations and restrictions. Punishments shall be no more. Strictly pulling in of the peace and a burning off of the desire to kill and to harm. The desire to kill and to harm and to control shall be no more once your borders and your boundaries are lifted. For a oneness within your human nation, all of your nations will be one before any of the burning off of earth within your cycle of 4,000 years is once again complete. Sorry, I had to trans-channel that one. He just popped right in. looking at questions. Let's see. I'm going to put this one on the screen. This is from Sherry. Hello, Michael. I'm so blessed to hear from you. Thank you. Whenever I receive a reading, they see beautiful angelic energy around me. So I want to see more of your question. Why do they see this? I feel very honored and drawn to angels. You are naturally within your state of humility. You are blessed. We are honored by your presence, and you are honored by ours. The balance of that is why your angels show around you. Your particular soul stream helps that flow. your humility, the blessings that you have for humanity, your discernment within lack of negative judgment is the reason why the angels are shown. However, they are there for all of humanity. You choose to see them or feel them as you will. They are there around all humanity. Thank you. Let's see. This is a question about twin flames from Robin. So I will put that on the screen because I love questions about twin flames. They fascinate me. Let's see. Hello, Michael. I want to know about twin flames. Are they being guided to meet up this November and December? He nods vehemently. He's nodding a lot. And why? Okay. Are they being guided to meet up this November and December, and why? He said, and I'll go ahead and read your question, it's personal, but he said you already know the answer. You asked about someone named John and if you are twin flames, and he said you already know. He's saucy like that. When I ask about things important that I want to know personally, he states that I already know the answer. That's like a common question. Oh, you want me to read it? She's in the chat right now. The question is, I also want to know if John and I are twin flames or soulmates. He's overseas in the army, and will he be home with me soon? He says timing is the consideration that he feels isn't aligned to his free will choice. When he understands the recognition that it is more within his free will choice than he perceives, then yes, he should be home, and it will likely be soon. About November and December, he says the evolution of what humanity knows as twin flames, the definition of what humanity knows as twin flames, as being a way to evolve into your full self and your full nature, is going to continue. This pattern of the recognition of different and varying soulmates will continue as it helps you evolve. It helps you expand. November and December was a particular stage of enlightenment that occurred in your timing of September. So this was before what you perceive as months and dates. If following by that recognition and perception and definition, then it should have started in September and will continue until what you know of as February. As you head into what you call spring, you will spring forward into your full expansion as represented by ascension individually. Again, you are not ascending collectively. You are ascending individually, and this is why what you know of as twin flames are there. Thank you. Thank you. Love that. She said in chat, she expounded upon that a bit, and she said it's so bad where he is. And Michael's nodding to you, and he is offering to you a perception of his safety. So if John should within his free will call upon the safety around him, then Michael should show up as well. So he's offering that to him. All he has to do is ask. And he should not be personally affected if he asks and he believes. This is what Michael is saying to him about that particular war zone, because it is indeed a war zone. So call him in. John has to do that, preferably in spoken words. Michael likes spoken words. For those of you who aren't aware, what he's saying to me right now is that the shields and protections that formulate for safety around humans that he is well known for are because humans speak the words out loud. Verbal words are very important to his presence. Okay? So please, please, please tell John from Michael and via me to please speak the spoken words. Okay? Yeah, it commanded. Yeah, someone said that. Michael likes when humans step forth in their power to command something. That is when he shows up. When you say, I command my safety. This is the type of being that he is. Very, very strong. Okay. Yeah, everyone in chat is saying the energy is so overwhelming and I feel it in my skin. Believe me, I'm trying to keep a cool face for you guys, but I'm totally freaking out. Full authenticity alert. As you guys know me, as a member of the authenticity movement, I am so freaking out right now. Okay. Oh, that is a good question. I'm going to put that on screen. This is from Sophia. Oh. The question to Michael is from Sophia. What happens to a person's soul if they commit suicide? Try not to get emotional with that. Probably will be hard. That question touches me. So I'm going to step out of the way for a bit. What happens is up to you as source within you. There is no punishment. You will not receive what you call vindication or punishment or karma. It does not occur in that sense. What occurs is simply a further evolution. You likely will choose to try your same pre-birth intention and all of the methodology therein once more. But this too is a choice. You can drop that pre-birth intention. You can release that lesson. You are not punished for taking your own life. It is your life to take. You are the source. You should choose if you shall. You could choose to do it again or not. It is your choice. And there you go. No punishment or karma for that. Your source, I agree with him. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Let's see. Let's see, this question is from Marisa. I'm going to put it on the screen now. Open it up so I can probably see it. Marisa asked Michael, I was told by a healer that it's time for me to embrace the divine masculine. He is nodding. Can you tell me if this is so? He's nodding, yes. And if so, who are my divine masculine guides and how can I connect with them? He says they shall be shown to you and already have begun being shown to you through the presence of a specific bloodline that comes from a being that humans know as Hercules, Thor, Thoth, and Horus. Those bloodlines represent your masculine guides. And they shall be shown to you in that order. Okay. About embracing the divine masculine, please understand that the nature of the divine masculine is always to accompany the divine feminine. It is not and or. They are together. They are as one. And they are something further than mere divine masculine and mere divine feminine. When they are combined, something powerful occurs for you that shall be the next step in human evolution. I like that. It reminds me of a conversation that I had on YouTube with someone named Gigi. You guys should go look that up. It'd be fun for you. Let's see, what else do we have with questions? My throat chakra is clearing as we speak, so I'm going to be coughing a lot and clearing my throat. out. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay, this is from Papinder. Hi, Michael. I love and appreciate you. Thanks for everything. I want to know how you help us. How do you protect us? What do you do when some entities are around us? I also heard about chakra removal stuff. Is it good to remove them? Oh boy, you asked that. Sorry, that was me, not him. You can totally tell when it's me from my ego. I'm like, oh, people are going to watch that and say, this is good and this is bad and this is right and this is wrong. And Michael's nodding. Okay, I'm uncomfortable with that question, as you can tell. He says, I protect you based upon your belief that it is possible. I protect you with the mighty source of your ethics within your spirituality and your truth and divine truths. I protect you by burning off what you perceive as disempowerment. This is not good or evil or right or wrong. This is a disempowerment state. I bring you to the full state of the power within what you know in your definition as the Merkabah. What do you do when some entities are around us? I'm just reading the second portion of your question. I allow them. You chose for them to be around you. Within your free will choice, I allow them until you choose that they should depart. When you choose that they should depart, my presence extends to you for what your perception of protection is. And that brings you to your space of empowerment. I help you release fear so that negative entities or your perception thereof are no longer perceived as negative or evil. I release fear. I cannot fully remove negativity from your life. If this were the case, there would be no earth. The wheels of light within you, for what you know as chakras, have been and will be as long as there is humanity and as long as there is earth. I cannot remove anything that you choose to keep. Your perception of them as necessary is your perception, therefore they are flowing within your human bodies. They operate your physical organs because this is what you should choose to believe. If you as a collective race should choose to evolve further, then yes, it is true that you should no longer need them. You are not currently in that state of alignment because this is not what you believe. Therefore, you are not aligned towards the necessity of removal of a part of yourself. This is something that you believe as a necessity within you. And as long as you are aligned to this belief, then these chakras, for what you call them as such, will function within your organs and your nervous systems. All of the systems within your body are operated by your chakras. You are not in an alignment towards believing that you should remove them at this present state and at this point of the now. When you are fully aligned towards your fifth, sixth, seventh, and tenth degree of your dimensional capacities, then you shall be in alignment towards no longer needing them. Currently, you believe that you need them, therefore you do. There is no perceived negativity that is truth about the chakra system. This is an alignment towards human perception of duality of good and bad. Chakras are not good or bad. They simply are. They are light, and they currently operate to help you connect your light body to your physical body. They are there for that purpose. And as long as you have a fifth dimensional, third dimensional, or fourth dimensional body, you shall need chakras. When you align in a different frequency, if you want, you don't have to have chakras. However, you are not there yet. Operate in your current state of alignment until you individually and then collectively no longer need them. And you will know when you no longer need them because the entirety of your physical light, your physical body will be a light body. When your physical body becomes a light body, you will no longer need chakras. Until then, you do, because you believe that you do. All right. This question is from Sinead. How can I live a full life while being so energetically charged and sensitive? Yeah, I agree. I sometimes feel like the energies and pulses on my chakras and spine require too much attention. I could meditate all day. I feel like I am possessed. What is the right way out? Is there any shortcut to release my vibration? Peace, God. He says there is no shortcut except you. You are the shortcut. Your belief is the shortcut. When you jump straight into a belief pattern, and he pointed with the tip of his sword like this, and he pointed at me and he said, when you jump straight into, and when he did that, I'm like, yeah, back it up, just a little breathing. When you jump straight into a belief pattern that you are done being disempowered, then a belief of aligning towards possession is not possible. The human fear-based perception that you even can be possessed, that it even is possible, is the problem. You are not possessed. I see you. I feel you. I know you. You are not possessed. You are blessed. He's speaking to you, by the way, very clearly to you, Sine. This wasn't just general. Your life is energetically charged. That is the purpose. That is the flow of the healing power within you as set forth by your divine intent. When you step into a space of allowing, the energy and frequency of allowing will cause for you to formulate an acceptance of these energies. All of the pulses and pressure and release within your chakras is because they are alive. You are alive. You are flowing. These chakras are moving and spinning because you are alive. If you release the need to feel more grounded, that is helpful. Step fully into the power of these energies. Step into your power. That is the shortcut. It's the release of your panic. You are panic. You are panicked and fearful. When you release your panic and your fear, then this should be possible. But there is no way out. There is no out. This is. Everything is as it should be, based upon your choice. And when you formulate an acceptance and allowance of this, then you shall feel comfortable with the way that your energy flows within your chakra systems. And then you shall no longer seek a way out. Thank you. He's so powerful. My throat is feeling better already. Feeling so much more clear. Let's see what else we have going on in your questions. All right, this is a good question. This question is from Linda. Can you please explain what a fallen angel is? Are you one? What is the purpose of a fallen angel? I am not fallen. You are not fallen. There is no down. There is no up. I am not that perception of which you call Lucifer. I'm not even fully the perception of what you call an archangel. My name is Michael, for what you know thereof, and always has been, and always will be. that there is no such thing in truth. For the definition of fallen, no one falls, they choose. There was no heaven to fall from. Please understand that your human definitions of heaven and hell and limbo and all of these things that are there is not what it really is. Is not what it really is. Angels play roles. They have specific roles based upon their contracts with Source, just like you as humans have contracts with Source. Angels play roles. And my role is to empower and complete the burning nature of the passions within you, to awaken, enlighten, and activate you as a human race. I did not have to fall to do that. And no one ever has fallen, not even Lucifer. Thank you. That was an interesting answer. Again, I want to say that if anyone feels like the question was skipped, it could have been because Michael did not understand, or well, not understand, but he chooses questions based upon the lack of personal nature. So the less personal your question is, particularly if you have questions that say, does Michael align specifically to me? When I ask him those questions, he will say to me, I don't align specifically with one person. I align with humanity as a whole, and anyone can call me in. He doesn't align towards having specific connections with one human being or any groups of human beings or anything like that. So when people have asked me more personal questions about how they know him or what their alignment was, I have no idea what your questions were, but if they were from that standpoint, he has told me to tell you, individually and as a collective whole, that he aligns with everyone very personally, not just one person. So that could be why the question wasn't answered. Other than that, I'm not sure. We probably haven't gotten to them yet. There are hundreds and hundreds that I'm seeing, and I'm just picking them as they come up, literally as they come up. And I'm skipping people who have asked more than one, and I'm just going with it. So if you have a question and you're not seeing me get to it, it might be helpful to ask it in chat. And if he aligns to it, I will answer it for you, okay? I hope that clears up, you know, the order in which questions are being answered. It clears up that concern. I'm just answering exactly what he tells me to answer. I'm not being showing any bias or anything of that nature. Just going straight for it. Okay. Let's see. I'm scrolling on right now only because there are a few that have already asked. And some of these questions have been answered already. So those that have been answered already, I'm also skipping those. Okay. This question is from Rion Tan. In times of chaos, fear, terrorisms, or deaths, how do we maintain love and peace in our being to radiate outwards to help? He said, understand that I am there amongst it all. Understand that you are there amongst it all. Extend love to that which you do not understand. Extend mercy and compassion and strength to what you deem as the terrorist, to what you deem as the murderer, the rapist, killer. All of these beings that you perceive as evil, extend mercy and love to them as you would towards the person that you placed in the position of the victim. Extend love and peace to all. And then there should be no more terrorism. This releases fear. This act of mercy and compassion and strength releases that fear. Understand the role and understand them as God's source reflecting back and playing a role for the perceived victims. Extend love and shine it from within. Then shine it into the chaos. That is all. Join together. Individually and collectively, you could do this, join together. When you do this together as a human conscious collective, then there will be no more fear, no
of terrorism or war. Okay.
See, I love his answers because I personally, as a human, have a very hard time with that. When I think someone's hurting someone that is, you know, perceived as weaker, I cry. And the Divine Mother in me kind of gets very, very protected. Yeah. Okay. Okay, I'm going to delete some of these questions that have already been asked. Let's see. Move towards another question. This is a good question. And even though this person has already asked the question, I'm going to answer it anyway because many of you are asking. Okay, and it is a good question, and he likes it too. This is from Johnny. What are the things that archangels and guides can do and manipulate in our physical experiences? Does that change with dominant guides versus subdominant? He says dominant versus subdominant guides, they are interchangeable and they are changing based upon your evolution and what you perceive as integration. They are interchangeable. Subdominant guides come and go based upon your need and based upon your calling, based upon when you call and for what you call, excuse me. Insofar as the question regarding what can archangels do to manipulate in our physical experiences, he said, I am a prime source to help you manipulate your physical environment. I do this via the activation of your Kundalini awakenings. This is your definition of what I do. I am responsible for activating what you call the root chakra in combination with what you call the Merkaba. The power of these two forces within you activates your passions to burn off the lack of necessity. There are many necessary portions of your ego, and then there are toxic portions through which your ego operates. I burn off the toxic. This is a funny question. I can't help but to ask it because this is funny. Michael, there was a discussion in our Facebook group not long ago that you guys could see us even in the washroom, and I don't agree with it. I know you see us energetically. That's why I never ask anyone to leave me alone in the washroom. I'm sorry, but that's hilarious. Okay, so he says, and he's trying to be all serious, like he's not even laughing, like I'm laughing, and he's just standing there like there's no humor in that, right? He's not one of the angels that particularly laughs at me when I bring him in. He just stands there in seriousness until I get done with my human shenanigans. So he states, I see you through different dimensional capacities, and I don't choose to see you in that way and in that particular. Yes. He's being all serious and classy about it. There you go. I guess that he's trying to say he doesn't even want to see you in that way. And no. So, and I agree. Like, I love you, but I don't want to see you in that way. In that way. So he has a certain ethical component about how he chooses to see humans, and that, yeah, that's not one of them that he goes towards. Someone else is asking in chat, what about other beings? Can they see us naked and stuff? Okay, yeah, we do need to talk about that because I talked about that in my channeling workshop. I do offer workshops for these kind of, you know, channeling beings of this nature and others. And in my channeling workshop, someone asked me this question. And my answer to that is exactly what someone else just said in chat. They see us and they don't care. Exactly, they don't care. Basically speaking, they, in that capacity, there are many types of beings, including angels, that see you. And because they don't hold any particular connection to shame or guilt or, you know, any, they're so unabashed that they just don't care. They're like, okay, something human going on here. Yeah, all right, whatever. And they just keep doing their angelic things. They don't care. They're not ashamed. But Michael, not so much. He doesn't seem to show up in that way, according to him. But there are many, many other beings that do, and they don't care. They pop right in and out of that dimension, not even caring what you're doing. So judgment is absent in their perception. Absolutely. That's what someone just said in chat. Absent in their perception. Yep. So yes, let go of your shyness, because once you begin to channel, you when you start to see how many of them are actually there, when you see into the ether, you will understand that you may as well lose your shyness, because they're not going away. Privacy is then gone. Got it? Mm-hmm. So yeah, same thing. Someone said, well, what do you do when you see a kitten in the litter box? You know, do humans walk away? No, not really. It's just a kitten in the litter box, right? Same thing. I agree. So someone is asking in chat a very good question. This is from Bo. Do archangels and guides act differently with different people? Yes, because he says, because your perception is relative to source within you. Your expression of source within you is very personal. Therefore, your perception and interpretation of us is going to be unique to what you choose to comprehend in within your specific alignment and within your specific understanding. So yes, absolutely, they do act differently. Yeah. Oh, this is a good question. This is from Sophia. What are the angels' relationships with demons, and what are their differences? I knew someone was going to ask that. This is going to be fun. Your demons, and notice I said your demons. They are reflections of your perceived fragmented oversoul layers. The perception of being fragmented is but a perception. However, you bring it into a physical reality which you define and create. From your fear, you create demons. From your space of love, you create us and your particular individual perceptions of angels. Angels are Elohim beings that have been in existence since the beginning of what you know as time. However, demons are a human creation that has become a physical manifestation therefrom. They operate to further perpetuate your perceived notion of contrast. Without dark, there would be no light. When you step fully into light, you will not even perceive that dark is negative. You will simply perceive it as a necessity and not a negative. Therefore, you would not even perceive a demon as a negative at that state of being. Thank you. This is a question to Michael from Sarah. How do I address an issue with consistency? I start projects and rarely finish, and it has become a habit now. What is my block to perseverance? He states, please understand that this is a continued concern in the human conscious collective with not knowing what you want. The problem with lack of consistency, perseverance, and lack of passion is just that. If passion does not persist, then it is not within alignment towards your wants of what you choose to create. It is possible that you should have passion to begin and then lose passion somewhere along the way. This is not exactly inconsistency.
This is a change in your personal and individual alignment. Forgive yourself for these changes. If you don't finish, it means your alignment changed. Stop resisting. Is that what you're saying? Stop resisting your lack of inconsistency. Embrace it as alignment and perpetual changes to your alignment. Okay, please don't mark my screen off. I saw it almost happen again. Did you see that? Let's see if he wants to say anything else. If the alignment should continue to change, even daily, even every moment, allow it to change. Your allowing is what will cause your eventual consistency when you come to a point wherein you can state, I am completely safe and accepting and allowing of every change, even if it is changing within every moment, and even if I never know. If this is your state of being and in your state of mind, then you will become passionate and dynamic and flowing and empowered in your full beingness. Make it a habit to stop trying to change your alleged lack of consistency. Why is consistency needed? Just do. Just be. Just allow and accept. You cannot perceive to understand or release a block until you say there is no more block. This is who I am. Thank you. Okay. Oh, that's a cute question from an 8-year-old. You know the mother in me cannot even not answer that. I need to. That's so adorable. This is a question from Elle. My 8-year-old Zach wants to know if there are fun activities like soccer games in higher dimensions, or would we just sit around knowing things? He is so cute. I know someone in chat just went, aw, and they're like, my inner child went, aw, too. Yeah, he's so cute. He says, but even the serious things are games. To us, the serious things can become fun. And there are many, many degrees of dimensions. There are many, many games. And yes, there is soccer. If you want it, it is created for you. That's cute. Let's see. There's another question. This question to Michael is from Lois. Is there any good reason to fight over land or area such as the Dome of the Rock? Are there any places that are portal / nexus type areas physically on Earth? He says there are many portals, many, many portals on Earth. There are many portal points on Earth, guided by what humans know as ley lines, the equator being the halfway point and the strongest ley line. Many portals occur that activate what humans know as chakra systems. Humans like to form definitive reference points. There are many. There is one in Peru. There is one in Australia. There is one in Utah. Hey, I didn't know that. When he says things I don't know, I go, what? There are 12 portal points that humans call chakra systems because they enjoy points of definition and reference. There are 12 portals.
Okay, the other question, let me ask him that. The reason humans fight over land and elements stems from the nature of contrast and duality, the roles of power and disempowerment, the roles of victim and aggressor, the roles of giver versus taker. Your duality on earth causes the versus. You choose it to learn as a collective. When you are at war, you are learning as a human conscious collective, not just individually. This is the reason that you fight in this collective manner. Yeah. Okay, let's ask another question. This question is from Tiffany. Can I ask for assistance when I do healing work and clearing work? He's nodding yes. He says yes, please. I keep getting hit with people's attached energies and it's been very hard for me. Any suggestions? He states, my suggestion is for you to walk through them without fear of attack, without fear that you are victim, without aligning to disempowerment. I suggest you walk through them minus fear. My suggestion is that you release fear that anything could possibly attack you. If you would like to call upon my help for that, please do. And I will cause you to be aligned to help from within. When you understand the nature of the power of your being and your isness, it will burn through fear. You don't need assistance. You are more powerful than your awareness dictates to you. Accept your power and walk through the fire. Yeah, he's like that. Let's see. This is a good question. I know I'm duplicating some questions, but they are questions that I want to know too, and that I know all of you want to know. What is the best way for a human to clear and purify their body and energy field? Is there any way of, in a short amount of time, resetting and releasing physical and energetic toxic buildup without death for the body? Not including fasting and adopting new habits of not adding toxic foods, emotions, relationships, or actions, etc. He giggled a little and he said, why would you not include that? And he did it in a very classy Google kind of, haha, why would you not include that? Yeah, he actually had not laughed this entire time, so that was fascinating that you got a giggle. He says, my understanding of that is to burn through and purify your human energy field via the releasing of fear. The only way to release fear is via courage. What is the opposite of fear for you? When you individually develop the opposite of fear, it will bring you through the energy that my presence lends to humanity, which is a burning passion, desire, motivated by fuel from your kundalini. It will awaken your kundalini. Anything you can do to awaken what you know of as your kundalini and your merkaba, the activation of the kundalini and the merkaba within the human physical body is the quickest way that you can release this and reset yourself without death of the physical body. However, also, again, please find the definition of the opposite of fear for you and use it to burn through the toxins. He wasn't laughing at you, by the way.
He was giggling. It was joyful.
It caused him amusement in a positive way. Michael doesn't laugh at people. Just letting you know, that's not his nature. But he found you to be amusing in the way that I'm perceiving him right now, and he's nodding to confirm, is that basically speaking, you don't even know the nature of your own power, and that amuses him because it makes him giggle, because he wants you to find the nature of empowerment within you personally. Because everything that you're asking, you're already doing it right now, and you didn't even know. So, here you go. Are his eyes fiery? Someone asked me that in the chat. Yes, they are, but they're from a white, pure type of fire that would occur. I've only seen that when I look in the ether. The only thing I can compare that to physically is the clarity of ethanol as it burns into the atmosphere. When you burn something from a physical fire state and it turns into a clear or white type of pure burning, his eyes look like that. Which also appears to me as, I don't know if you've noticed when, you know, in our physical reality, when you look at asphalt on the road, when after it rains and you notice that the rain is combining with the oils on the street, there is a little bit of a fume, like a clear fume that goes like that into the atmosphere. It looks a bit like that. Okay, it's purity. Yes, absolutely. Okay, let's go through a further question. This is a good question from Gina. How much longer will souls be on Earth entering human bodies? How much longer will you choose it, Michael states. That was so vague. I'm asking again, because I am painfully human, but I'm going to know. He said, at least another 4,000 years. At least. At the very minimum, and your earth will recycle twice again amongst the next 4,000 years. Okay, that was more clear, thank you. Sometimes I just don't give up. I'm like, no, not that vague answer, more. Give me my human answer. Let's see, this question is from Sam. I'm going to put this on screen now. How can we be emotionally more stable and stronger when we are in a low vibrational place? He said, please accept that the low vibrational place is not bad, it is not evil. Please stop and refrain from trying to change your emotional state as something that is other than exactly what it is. When you formulate a complete acceptance of all energy flux within you, you will then become stable and stronger. And then you will also align towards much easier states of being. Yeah. Allowance is what someone said in chat. Absolutely. I agree with them too. When I was going through my dark night of the soul in my life, I learned to accept it exactly as is, and I would wail and cry and get angry and just cry and cry and cry, and anything that was accepted exactly as it should be. And it didn't matter how many weeks or days or months it would happen. I just had to allow it to be. That is how my personal ascension occurred. Okay? Acceptance. Allowing. Yeah. He said 4,000 years. Someone asked that in chat. Did he say 3,000 for the next cycle? And he said 4. Just so you know. Okay. This is a good question from Beatrice. And I was thinking about that, and I knew this question would come out today in this channeling. The question is, I don't know if anyone has mentioned this, but I would like Archangel Michael's perspective on the Paris attack last night. As I described earlier, the continual state of victimhood and powerlessness in the human conscious collective will change. This brings about that change. When humans can stand forth as a whole, as you did, as many of you here today did so, to collectively send love and healing and light, not just to the victim, but to the aggressor, not just to the people who left their bodies, but to the people who are still embodied, who caused that suffering. When your mercy and your strength and your compassion is shown towards all levels of your perceived definitions of victim and aggressor, come to a whole state. That is when your earth will shift and recycle into a new state wherein war is no longer needed to do so. When earth no longer needs duality, it will recycle itself. This cycle has been occurring since the beginning of the dawn of what we call time, and this cycle is due. Not this year, not next year. No one knows these dates or times. No one, not me, not you, not the being through which I chant. And he just stepped in again. Hold on. Every time he does that, then I go, okay, let me go. Let me go take a rest, something like that. Yeah. Someone said people are stating that it is another false flag. I don't know what you mean by that. Whoever is stating that in the chat, if you're saying that people are stating that Paris, the Paris attack, is a false flag, I don't know what you mean by that. Yeah. So elaborate on it further, and if I notice it in chat, we will continue with that question. It's unfortunate for sure. Me speaking, not him. But angels understand how war is orchestrated to bring us to our utmost state of forgiveness and compassion and mercy and love. That's what I'm getting from him insofar as why it's necessary. And he's nodding. Someone mentioned something else in the chat about the Paris attacks that I found completely relevant that he was asking for me to bring up. Petra stated, it was not the terrorists, but it will be blamed on them. He nodded to confirm what you're just stating. It is not the individual man. It is collective man. And then you are distracted. And you form a belief that it is about individual terrorists. This is much deeper than that. The human veil is being lifted for you to understand that it's not just about individual groups of terrorists. Your government has been playing the role of terrorist for quite a while. Okay. That's a big role. Let's move forward. I'm just scrolling through, trying to get to some questions from people who have not asked. Okay, this is from Mongolia. And I'm sorry that I cannot pronounce that name, but you with the butterfly on your icon, I'm answering your question. Pamela, please ask about the Mongolian energy field and its future.
What is our mission as a nation? And from where has our nation come? He says, your nation is ancient. Your nation represents the root chakra of earth, through which this being is here today to guide you. This is her connection to your nation as well. Your nation represents the kundalini awakening for the majority of earth. It begins with the primal nature of mankind, and we represent the primitive and how it can evolve beyond the primitive. Your energy field is strong and burning. It is truth and it is ethical. You represent passion that can be ethical. You represent all that is primal and how the primitive can still be safe, that there can be no further fear in primitive man. This is your mission as a nation, to understand and release fear from your primitive state and to evolve while also accepting primitive as is. You embody tradition. You embody truth and beauty within the culture of your primitive traditions. You embody respect. I had to answer that because I love the Mongolian people. Can you tell when I'm back? I'm just like, da, 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 da. When he's talking, he's like, so blah, da, 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 da. Yeah. Okay, let's see. What further questions do we have? Okay, we will answer this one from Jenna, because she has not had a chance to have a question answered. Dear Michael, can you speak more about the 144th dimension? What is the main purpose and intention behind those connected to this dimension? What about the prophesied 144 souls incarnating to earth? He states, prophecies shift and change. The original prophecy was 144,000. It then became 144 million. It then will become 144 billion. There is no end to the number 144. It will perpetuate in as many as you have dimensions, which, by the way, is more than 144. Can I speak for those from the 144th dimension? I am that of the 144th dimension. The purpose behind my connection to this dimension is to allow for expansion. The purpose of this dimension is continued expansion, which is endless and timeless. Your individual purposes will be unique, but many of your collective purposes embody expansion, acceptance, release of human bias judgments, and the power of unity as a whole. When humans had originally decided that they were to ascend collectively, they stemmed from the 144th dimension. Now they have decided that they will ascend individually. But the purpose is still the same. Unity, empowerment, connection to all, acceptance, all of this. Okay. He stopped speaking, but if you have further questions about the 144th dimension, please put it in the chat portion of your screen. Okay. I'm looking for your questions to find someone who hasn't had a chance to ask a question. This one is from Beck. How can I begin to more fully believe that I belong on this planet and that I am safe here. Step into that which you fear. If you do not hold a belief system that you can do it alone, why should you continue choosing to do it alone? Why should there be weakness in your belief that you cannot do it alone? Why should you force yourself to do it alone? If you are fearful of being alone, don't be alone. Grant yourself permission to take from and share, to accept and allow courage amongst your loved ones to support you. If you, as a human conscious collective, can't do it alone, why should you, dear soul, force yourself to do anything alone? Stand and accept the love from others. Stand firmly in their love and support. Allow their courage to now be yours. Allow this to formulate a worthiness within you. Your fear is coming from a space of lack, wherein you don't feel worthy. Should it be enough that I grant that you're worthy? If I say that you're worthy, will you as a human then believe it? That is my question to you. Would you as a human then believe it? I state that you are worthy. Is that enough? You belong, but you should choose to belong. You are worthy, but you should choose to be worthy. You are safe. Focus on feeling the opposite of space in safety. What is the opposite of safety for you? Step into it, but not alone. Why should you have to do it alone? If you choose to never do it alone, accept that this too is okay. Okay. Let us ask more questions. Mm-hmm.
Oh, that is a good question. I love it.
This is from Lisa. Why is it that healers seem to have a weak throat chakra area? Is it that we put things down instead of speaking them? Many of the healers in your human conscious collective choose to take so much within them and perceive it in as external. There is no such external force. When you are in a flow of complete acceptance of all there is as coming from your internal state of being, then you shall naturally express it via your sound and your light, via your song of your voice, via your actions, via all of the manners that humans express, the body, your mind, your spirit, your expression. When you block your own perception of your expression, this is what occurs. And it is common because you choose to see everything in the external. When everything comes from within, you can stand as a whole. First, you must stand individually, and then you can stand collectively. Express from within. Express from within. Understand that there is no external other than that which you create from within. And continue your expression. Stop blocking your expressions due to that of fears. Fears of being attacked. Fears of entities latching on. Fears of psychic attacks, for what you call it. Fears of anything that can hurt you. Release your fear. Express. Express the soft pressure that you state that you feel on your body chakra points is a release. These are your chakra systems wishing to release an expression.
Okay, scrolling down to another question. I'm wondering, this is from Romy, I'm wondering in which way can we ask for his assistance? When we need strength to believe and go on in difficult times of fear and anxiety, simply ask for him? He says it is but a simple question. Ask, but state, and then command. When you ask, there is an uncertainty because it is a question mark. Should you choose to command that it is, that is the power that I convey to you. That is the power of my being and my isness within you. And that power is there for you because it is you. You may ask if your question then becomes a command. Okay, let's continue with more questions. Trying to just scroll down to one that has a person that has not had a chance to have their question answered. Okay, this is from Molly. Michael, what should I invoke of you to assist me with? I feel so unworthy. He states, you have answered your question. I feel unworthy. Can you change your belief about being unworthy, even slightly? It would not be ethical to the core of your being presently within your ego to state that you believe that you feel worthy if you indeed do not. What is the next state of believing this that you can feel that is closer to feeling worthy? What is your next step? That is my question to you. Your next step, other than unworthy, what is the closest step to feeling worthy? Go towards that and invoke me to assist with that next step, once you determine what it is. But it is the power of you that gets to determine what that step is. And yes, of course, I shall assist. I think that what he's trying to say is if she goes straight towards unconditional love, or she says, I am now worthy, and she changes herself in that way when she doesn't believe it, then it's not going to happen because of her belief system. He's nodding. Sometimes he points with a sword when he nods. I don't know if any of you have that same experience when you invoke his presence, that he comes with a sword and he's using it sort of like a you know, like a very powerful boss would at a corporate meeting, who's pointing the little thingy at the screen. Very powerful. Except it's with so much love. But yeah, he uses the sword a lot to point to certain things, or to make symbols of the sword in the air. And yes, the sword is definitely, when he showed up first, he showed up with it like this in his hands, and the sword was coming up like that, and it was right there. And he was like, and you called? And I'm like, ah, you're 2 seconds away from my face. You are 2 steps away from my face. And it didn't cause fear, but it just shocked me that he showed up ever so presently. And I said, you know, Michael, I channeled many, many angelic presences, but not you so much. Why not you? And he said, that is an excellent question. Why have you not asked? Just like that. Okay. So this is kind of the nature of his personality, from how I'm interpreting it. My reflection and my discernment is that his personality is strong and present and in your face. Beck said, so posh. Yeah. Let me scroll down to some people who haven't had a chance to answer some questions. Oh, that's a good question from Michael. Another person named Michael, I should correct that, from the human Michael. Michael Nevia states, are there any tips on transcending the dark night of the soul? He says, step through the dark as not being negative. Align to it for what it is. Walk through it as if you are walking through a tunnel through which you don't see light. Assume and imagine this question in your mind. What if there never is light? What if there never was? What if there never will be light ever again? This will bring you to the fullness of your dark night of the soul, to accept dark as something other than bad, to accept dark as something other than evil, to accept dark as something other than fear and chaos and destruction. Then all will be cleansed. All toxins within you will be purified. Such a wholeness will come thereby when you no longer feel that you need light. Then you will operate in both. And then there will be light. And then you will not fear. Hold no fear upon your stepping through the dark tunnel of that dark night of the soul. Hold no fear. Yeah, there you go. I never know what to say after his answers. I'm like, okay, that was so clear and so succinct and so precise that I kind of just go, yeah, okay. Mind blown. Thank you, Michael. Let's see. This question is from Jennifer. Archangel Michael, thank you for being here with us today. My question is, when I pray for your protection, I imagine you using your sword through my house like a knife cutting through butter. He was nodding at you and moving his knife like he's cutting through butter, and he's moving it in an affinity sign like this. Cutting away all of the negativity. How does it actually look when you use your sword? And how does it work when you protect someone's home? He said, and he's kind of showing me versus just saying, he said, it is my sword cutting through the density of the third dimensional environment and cutting through the physical so that you can have clarity and purity. And he is moving the sword not just up and down, but he says he moves it like this in my hands. It's moving in a figure eight fashion like that. When he slices through negativity, he goes choop and then choop and choop. Yeah, like that. That's what he's showing. Yeah. And he does do, someone said he touches their shoulder with the sword. He does that to me when he really wants to get my attention, to get me out of fear. He will lightly touch my shoulder. He will lightly touch it, just like a whoop. Sort of like in the movies when you see the knights, when they dub the knights. He does that motion sometimes to people, I've noticed. He's nodding to confirm. And that is to connect you. And he connects both sides. That's a symbolic representation of connecting you. So let's see what else we have. This question, let's see, looking through all the questions to make sure everyone gets a chance, because I'm going to have to end this broadcast soon in order to get some food and rest and be human. This question is from Kimberly. Hi, Michael. As you know, I love you so much. The nodding thing. I just want to know a couple of things. What are your true connections? What are my true connections with you? Am I truly your descendant? The reason why I'm answering this question for her is because he wants to answer it collectively. He said all Syrian beings are his descendant, but all descendants of Lyra and the Lyran star system are his descendants. And yes, you are. But he said it's not just you. I don't just choose individuals, I choose collectively, and you choose collectively. Can you tell me if I was in a scene? He said, I do not wish to tell you at this present moment, I wish for you to journey through your timeline to discern this answer for yourself. He can get a little cheeky, people. I was just telling management this while we were deciding how we were going to answer your questions prior to this podcast, because he kind of comes in and he goes, oh, you know, not so much. You're going to find that answer for yourself. And he kind of comes in and he's been doing that as I've noticed you answer your questions. He can get a little, what I call saucy, you know, and passionate. And he'll say, no, not going to answer that. He's a very good teacher. He chooses you. He wants you to go within. And he will give you these collective answers, but not so much. He hasn't been giving me many individual answers. It's been very rare that he's been giving those answers away. He'll say, well, what do you think about that? Or you answered your own question, or things of that nature. Yeah, very zen, but also powerful. Okay. So, but insofar as going through the Akashic timelines, they're right there. They're right there within you. They're right there. Okay, so let's see. He is confirming that you do connect with the Trinity and that you do connect with three. You asked that question and he nodded. And that's the only answer he seems to be willing to give. Yeah, he's like that. My apologies. He's not apologizing, but I will. He apologizes for nothing. Let me get that out of the way. Let's see. Oh, this is a good question that everyone could definitely stand to learn from about sleep apnea. And this question is from David. I have sleep apnea, which is the stopping of the breathing when asleep. What is the root cause of this? I read that constriction is involved. He nodded. He said, he's showing me an image of a mountain. He's showing me that in my mind right now. And how the tectonic plates within the earth shift and form pressure. And then these plates push together and then up comes the mountain. He said that is the natural flow of human energy. And when it is applied from pressure, it normally flows in this direction, up from the kundalini, through your merkaba, and out through your lungs and your throat chakra. But when your core beliefs push down from restriction-based core beliefs and constriction-based core beliefs, when your being, when your human being pushes down and you suppress yourself, and you push all of your expressions down into you, that's fear-based. And that causes the restriction. And then your lungs, your physical manifestations of sleep apnea is caused by your lungs feeling pressure of your own pushing of yourself. You are restricting and constricting your higher self until the pressure causes a cutoff point of your oxygen. So you cut from your own wellspring of your higher self. Release you, express you, and your waking moments express you. And then in your sleeping moments, your breathing will not be altered. Yeah. Thank you. Let me scroll down to further questions. Okay, this question is from Paul, and the question is, who are of the seraphim? The lineage of the seraphim extend through the Lyran race. They were originally source energy, and when they chose to incarnate as Lyran beings, that was 1 degree of separation from what you know of as prime creator or source energy. These humans who come down through this specific bloodline are of seraphim, but there are many, many, many more of which you are not even aware, of which you hold no human point of relativity or reference. There are many more. that have always been. Okay, let's see. What else we have with questions? This question is from Jordan. Can we strengthen the connection energy as we receive from you, as well as other angelic beings, with the use of angelic sigils, sacred geometry, and meditations focused on these types of things? He said, some of these symbols are indeed my symbols. Some have been altered. Use your own discernment, mind, and sphere to choose which symbols resonate with you. I prefer the flower of life, but I enjoy many symbols. As long as you don't hold a fear-based belief attached to the symbol, it is your definition of the symbol. If you chose a new symbol today that represented me, I would come. Use your discretion and discernment to sift through the alignment to the symbols that have been, that have deviated from their true meaning, or create your own meaning. Either way, what you choose to align with when it comes to me, I am there. So, well, lovely beings, I've enjoyed this, but I do need to go get some human rest and food and meditation. And I tried to sit through as many questions as possible. I want to apologize if I did not get through your question. And this show will be up on YouTube probably. You can find me on YouTube as Pamela Aaralyn if you want to view it. I've really, really enjoyed it. This was a very different experience for me from all of the channelings I've ever done. This was the most distinctly different channeling I've ever done. I did not expect this at all. This was quite powerful, and I enjoyed every moment of it with you. I thank you for standing there as an equal to me in all that I do and in my path individually, because my path represents yours and yours represents mine. I, as a channel, am but a mere human, and we stand in our humanness together, you know, in the power of this particular archangel today, and I'm so grateful to just channel him through to you and to be that conduit. So thank you for giving me the space to do that and to share that with you. I'm so grateful. Thank you so much. I love you. And I will end with that. Namaste.